Hello, everyone, and welcome to episode 203 of the Classic Elite Podcast. My name is Scott. We got Dustin with me. What's up, man?
I was a little early on that one.
That's my fault. I was balking a little bit. I noticed I left you hanging in the shoulder shake there.
It's all good.
That's how I was at like middle school dances too. It's like slightly off.
Just slightly off.
You know what I mean? Could have been right there. So everyone, thank you very much for joining us for the podcast. And if you'd like to join us live while we record on Twitch, you can participate in the chat room like our buddy Zarek is. And that's twitch.tv/classic_elite. And we talk about video games, but usually what we've been up to and whatnot before we get into that stuff. But we got to start this week a little bit on a down note, Dustin.
Yeah.
So you want to tell people, I guess, kind of bad news that we have to share?
Yeah, I follow Richie Branson on Facebook, and I noticed the other day he posted that he has been diagnosed with cancer.
Which sucks to hear.
Yeah, it's a bummer. He didn't specify what type, so I'm not sure, and I, of course, don't want to like pry with a bunch of weird questions from some stranger. Absolutely. Right after he got such horrible news. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's a real bummer. If you're the praying type, definitely send some up for him. Our thoughts are with him. Our prayers are with him.
And at very least, go buy some of his music. Cheer him up a little bit.
Yeah. Go buy all of his music.
Yeah. I just Google Richie Branson and you'll find him. I did think of him the other day. And I forgot to mention this on the podcast. I was watching Jeopardy last week. I love Jeopardy, right? Oh, we talked about mm-hmm. that either on the show or after. And there's this girl on, and you know how Trebek does those weird interviews after mm-hmm. their first commercial break? Well, one contestant, her like factoid was that she loves nerdcore music. And right? And Trebek was like, oh, so losers. Like, was a real dick about it. And it kind of blew up in the, like, Richie Branson, Mega Ran sphere. And there was an amazing collaboration rap video. Did you see that?
Yeah, it was excellent.
Of them, like, ripping on Trebek. It was well-deserved. And I remember watching it live thinking, like, oh, my God. Like, that, what a dick. And then it blew up kind of the next day. And I'm like, all right. Yeah, like, that's awesome. Suck it, Trebek, right?
Mega Ran got his entire crowd to yell that at one of his shows.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Suck it, Trebek. That's awesome.
Yeah.
So, but on a serious note, yeah, our thoughts are definitely with Richie Branson. If you're interested in, if you've never heard of him, when he released an album around the MMO, the Star Wars MMO, we had him on the show. It was episode 80, look, between 80 and 85, and he was a guest on our mm-hmm. show. Super fun interview. But all right, well, I guess let's get into how our regular lives have been before we get into some gaming news. So anything exciting or new to report, man?
I went to the pumpkin patch.
How was that?
It was cool.
I guess the real question is, did Sully have a good time?
He had an enormous amount of time.
Okay.
Enormous amount of fun. Enormous amount of time.
Well, at that age you do. That's what you have.
Yeah. That too, yeah. Yeah, there was like this big hill. It's like this huge farm, and we go there like every year, and there's like this big hill, and it's like covered in plastic, but like a hard plastic, so you can like slide down it on a burlap sack.
Oh, sweet.
They have zip lines, they have a corn maze, hay rides, like animals to feed and pet. Like it's huge.
That's
deal.
Amazing.
Yeah, it's awesome.
I would love to do the giant slide thing down the hill like you're talking about.
Yeah.
You guys don't really... Do you get enough snow for him to actually go proper sledding?
Not really.
So, yeah. So, next best thing.
This is going to be a good episode.
Oh, neither of us can talk. Yeah, sorry. I've had one of those weeks where it's just having to be in customer service at times is really challenging.
Mm.
So, I am with my Canadian bad week juice.
Ooh.
That's all right. What are you going to do? I think it's still brewed. I think it's only by label anymore. The Molson Canadian. I think it's brewed in Golden, Colorado. So, it's label alone. I think our Guinness is like that, too. It's like brewed in Minnesota or something. So, Zarek is pointing out, Dustin, my Halloween game is stronger than yours right now.
Yeah. So I think the pinnacle of my Halloween is basically my horror marathon at this point.
Wait a minute. That sounds a little hypocritical to me.
It is. It's 100% hypocritical.
Okay. All right.
Because like, people keep talking about Halloween. I'm like, dude, that passed. Oh, no. It's like this Monday. Okay. I get it. I forget that it's like a place where like you go and you trick or treat. Because it's so ingrained in my mind now that it's just when we do our horror movies.
Yeah. And I don't understand my webcam stuff. Look, Detroit's backwards. My curtain keeps flip-flopping back and forth between episodes. Like I'm noticing my name spelled backwards.
I was trying to represent. That's weird because it's right for me.
But if it's right for you, it's wrong for YouTube.
That applies to everything, really.
Yes. So no big deal there. I'm trying to think. I've played some games. I've got a lot. I've got two parties to go to this weekend. I've got a wear a costume if you want party on Friday.
Which no one's going to do.
Which no one's going to wear a costume?
Yeah.
See, that's the danger of these things. So you kind of have to half-ass a costume, right? You got to show a little bit of spirit, but if you're too zealous, people think you're weird, right?
Right.
My go-to in that situation is a priest. Now, okay. if I'm going to go all out, I'm a really good Billy Mays when I paint on like a beard.
Yeah, that's awesome. All right.
So that's my go-to if it's like serious and I got to pull something neat off. But yeah, so I got that. And then my buddy is doing like kind of a barbecue, making brisket and doing like inflatable jump houses for the kids and stuff. So he's having a big like Halloween get together for. Well, I'm like the only one of their friends that doesn't have kids. So like I'm just like the dude that shows up and drinks beer with Nate, which is
jumps in the jump house.
I'll try to restrain myself. But I do like playing with the kids because like all the parents are exhausted, right? They're around kids all the time.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not. So like I'll play with them. Like I'll like play fetch or like throw them up in the air, like push them high on the swing. Where like the moms are usually like, oh my God, I've been pushing them for hours this week. You know, for me, I'm not burnt out. So
did you say play fetch?
I did say fetch. I meant catch. But when they're like 3 and 4, that's what it is.
Yeah, pretty much.
Because, like, if they throw it, it goes up a little bit and lands a foot away from them.
Yeah.
So they turn into Scotty from Sandlot when he has to run the ball to Dennis Leary. Oh, Zarek. Yeah, he says, what, Scott, you're going to dress up as a priest and play with children? No, those are two separate parties. I will not be hanging around kids in a priest outfit. But I did get put on a priest catalog mailing list.
Okay.
I bought like actual priest attire from Amazon. So they send me these like really like JCPenney catalog style. Like, I didn't know you could just buy that shit. I thought there was like some sort of like buffer between consumer and church or whatever. I just assumed. No, dude, you can just wholesale buy whatever you want and then just bless it. And all of a sudden it's like the church official thing. It's really funny.
I mean, isn't it just a catalog with the same pants and shirt over and over and over?
Yes, but you can also get like different, like ornate, like crosses and cups and stuff.
Oh, okay.
Finally, I got fret up enough that I just called him. I'm like, I'm not a priest. I'm very far from a priest. Please stop mailing this stuff to me.
You get like bulk collars.
I didn't know the shirt that I bought came with a collar. But I went and bought like a 5-pack. Like, you do buy them in bulk.
Yeah.
I wouldn't think you'd sweat through them, but apparently you do. If you get lazy, you can always do like some printer paper, right? Leftover pizza box and a printer paper. No one will know the difference. So, yeah, okay. So I guess let's get into gaming news, and that's what we've been up to this week. Before we get into news, Dustin, do you have any update on the TurboGrafx-16 recap kit?
No, we've been so busy recently. I haven't even touched it.
Okay, I understand.
I got a pumpkin though, from the pumpkin patch.
There you go. How long before? Oh no, have you carved it? I guess it's like, I can't believe it's like 4 days away from Halloween.
Yeah. Actually, I didn't. It's probably still sitting in the trunk because I was telling Kim to carve it because I've already carved two this year.
That seems fair.
Yeah.
Did I ever tell you about the pumpkin that we let rot in my dorm room freshman year?
No, I don't think so.
My college roommate, his mom was a very sweet lady, but sometimes was a little ditzy. So she wanted Zach to have the Halloween spirit and the fall spirit. So he went home one weekend, came back with a pumpkin, right? Well, college kids, lazy, dorm, no big deal. You don't think about it. Well, we had to go home for some, like, very long break. Oh, I think it was, he brought it home prior to Halloween in October, and then we were cleaning out to not have garbage in the room over winter break, because where I went to school, there was a six-week break between Thanksgiving, and then you didn't have to go back to school until after New Year's.
Cool.
Which was great, but we had neglected to even touch that pumpkin since he had brought it. So when we picked it up to throw it away, the bottom had completely rotted out, but just perfectly so that if it was undisturbed, you wouldn't know everything was rotted. So as soon as we picked it up, all the rotten, like, disgusting guts, like, flew out all over the floor. Everybody was complaining about the smell in the hall of our dorm. Like, it was bad.
It's awesome.
Oh yeah. So yeah, those things spoil. So how so it's like 2 weeks like before Halloween that you should normally do those?
Yeah, you can if you get like bleach and water and spray your, you can soak your pumpkin in that and then dry it out and then coat it with like vinegar and water and another solution and it will like stay fresh for weeks.
Huh. You think that would show up in like Fargo or something? It was like a way to like embalm like a body. So, good deal, man. Well, let's save the big news for last, I guess, just because that'll be easier to talk about. I was listening to, I'll get to that in a bit. Voice actor strike. Did you see anything about this?
I did. I looked at that article, and it looks like they aren't being unreasonable.
I agree. And I am politically, like, not very favorable of unions. However, I'm not unreasonable, and when there's certain situations where it makes sense, it makes sense. This union seems to be not being unreasonable at all.
Yeah. It's basically, they're asking for like royalties?
I think it's royalties, and a big crux of the argument is it's deteriorating their vocal cords with some of the repetitious screaming that they have to do, and actors and other mediums have this as well. And there's no, there were certain thresholds that seemed reasonable as well, wasn't it? Like, they wouldn't get royalties unless it hit, like, 5 million in gross sales or something, or...
I think it was every 2 million. Like, every 2 million sales or downloads. Up to 8 million.
Okay, so it could be capped as well.
Yeah.
And, I don't know. I do understand kind of the pushback of where does it stop, because developers don't get those royalties, and... some of the artists, or actually none of the artists, like the visual artists, get those royalties. So why should the voice actors be treated any differently?
Yeah.
So I can understand that point. And it is a little jarring when someone like Will Wheaton says, well, then they should ask for it too. And that's a mentality that can ultimately be damaging to the company that is producing it. And people do love their AAA games, right? Like, there is a huge market for that. If everybody is constantly getting their hands in the profit jar,
yeah,
at some point there's the market will fail because games will cost too much because the companies do still have to earn profit to keep their shareholders happy. So mm-hmm. it's one of those domino effect, catch 22 kind of things. So, but again, on this particular situation and the contracts that they're trying to negotiate, I agree. They don't seem unreasonable at all.
Yeah.
Yeah. Any other thoughts?
It makes me wonder if there's anything if there's an analogous scenario. Like voice actors in video games, like voice actors in cartoons, is there something like that in cartoons, movies?
There's probably some of that, but it probably isn't just because they're a voice actor.
Yeah.
Or like me, I don't know. I don't know. I don't know enough about it. I'd be totally speculating, so I guess I don't want to try to do that. But there's got to be some sort of precedent somewhere, right, for them to look at.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. It's, yeah. So, it definitely interesting. And it'll be like this. Do you remember when the writers did the strike for TV? Mm-hmm. We're not going to see the downfall of this for a while.
Because
the games that are coming out have already been made. But here for a year or two, we could really notice a big issue, especially if they don't like get a new collective bargaining agreement or whatever.
Well, you know, that could be good for your no names. Like they could find the next Troy Baker.
Yeah, absolutely.
Everybody else is on strike.
But that's also part of the downfall is then it's tough to get into that. You're either a scab or you're in the union. Mm-hmm. But if you're not, it's a tough situation. It can be a lot of politics involved in just trying to do what you love, which is unfortunate.
Or we could go back to like the 90s and the developers are like, well, to hell with it. We'll just get the custodian to do the voice acting. He's got a deep voice and we'll get like awesome shitty voice acting again.
You know, Chris Metzen over at Blizzard did, I think still might even do, he retired, but he's done a lot of the voices, and that's because like he was just there to do it.
Yeah, that's awesome.
Supergiant Games, like their buddy Logan, they just happen to know a dude with a voice like that. I love Bastion. What a good game.
I still need to play that.
Oh, well, it's not too long. And it'll always look beautiful, so it's got great gameplay. You'd like it. So definitely don't let it go too far in your backlog. Also, there's a lot of people very upset with Bethesda right now. Have you followed any of this news?
I read that they're not giving press copies.
Yeah, they're not giving press copies more than a day in advance for any of their games, starting with the new Skyrim Remastered and Dishonored 2. They did this for Doom. And no matter how you read their press release about it, as Jim Sterling said, it's pretty, maybe it's a total biscuit. I'm going to link both of their videos. It's pretty insulting to the consumer that they can't see that they're trying to prevent negative press or mitigate it. Or, if you're only giving traditional press, people that rely on those review scores, a day to review the game, even though it's a $60 purchase, like you're upping that impulse buy factor. And I think that mm-hmm. they're very aware of that. It's within their right. I'm not disagreeing with that, but it feels like they're trying to go against the grain on a system that seemed to work okay. I mean, Doom was awesome. They should have wanted that reviewed.
Are they just... Is it basically they're just like, well, we're Bethesda?
Yeah, pretty much. And there are very few games that you and I will buy, will pre-order.
Mm-hmm.
So this doesn't affect us because we would be willing to wait on a Bethesda game for the reviews.
Yeah.
But it's strange. eventually the pendulum would swing back because a lot of people that want press coverage will give their games, like the independent people. They're like, I don't have an embargo. Like, if you want to talk about my game, here, talk about it, please. Like, play it.
Yeah.
And, you know, they'll kind of miss out on some stuff like that. Yeah, Jim Sterling had a little nod to Owlboy in his video that Jared pointed out to me. And I'm excited, man. Owlboy comes out in a couple days.
Oh, wow.
November 1st.
All right.
Be a good Monday. I might try to stream that.
Yeah.
Like, why not, right?
Yeah.
High-res pixel art. Beautiful stuff. I don't know. I guess just... What's your gut tell you about that? Like, what's your gut reaction? Does it bug you, or is it not?
Not really. I mean, Bethesda is... Like, there's a chance that Dishonored 2 won't be good. Other than that, like, the next Elder Scrolls game is going to sell a bajillion copies. They don't need, like, the early review copies out.
Yeah, that's a good point.
Probably just cost some money. So they're like, nah, screw it.
Yeah, I guess, yeah, there is that to consider. Like, it could, what really would be their benefit at times? If it's mediocre or, as Jim Sterling said, he was labeled as a wild card. If they're not going to give a predictable score, you could kind of only hurt yourself.
Yeah. Yeah. I think it's smart on their part. I mean, they're basically like, if Rockstar wasn't giving out early copies, well, they don't have to. They're Rockstar.
I agree. It's definitely not their, they're well within their right to do that. And I don't know, like, it does suck for the people that do make their livelihood having their audience, but that shouldn't be a concern of Bethesda at all.
Yeah,
like,
agreed.
If someone's making a living reviewing your products, like, why do you care, good or bad? It's inconsequential when it comes to the actual development of that specific game. Maybe they'll want feedback and whatnot, but getting that information out to the consumer, I could see them wanting to hold off as long as possible with how huge games are now.
Yeah.
It does. If you want to know if a game's good or not, though, you are going to have to wait a little longer than normal.
But yeah, you should probably wait a little longer anyway.
Pretty much, yeah. You're right. You should.
The longer you wait, the better the game's going to be, because it's going to be patched, and the cheaper it's going to be. So wait. It's fine. Don't buy it the first day.
There's a shitload of games out there that you haven't played that you probably own, right?
Yeah.
So, yeah, I agree. It's a weird situation. But, yeah, again, it's well within their right, and I understand why some people are upset about it. And oh, well. But it's big news in the gaming world, so we had to at least talk about it, right?
Yeah. Are they, like, I see it's not, they're not giving early review copies. Are they giving review copies in general?
I believe so, yes. They just won't get them. The slippery slope with it, though, and Total Biscuit's big point was, it really is going, the reason he called it anti-consumer, his biggest point was because with the way that the traditional press operates, it's going to degrade the quality of the review most likely, because people will have a shorter amount of time, but the reward of being the first review is pretty substantial still as far as getting the views and whatnot. So I do understand that ripple effect, but again, what would Bethesda care? That's only going to benefit them.
Yeah.
If the first several hours are great. I mean, look at Skyrim on PS3. If you only had a day to play it, you'd never know that late in the game it becomes such a RAM mess that you have a 12-second lag in your attack. Like, it just, no one would know that unless they played through all of it. So, Zarek thinks it's slimy and unethical. I think the way they presented it definitely is. Oh, well, a cool thing, Justin, I was watching the World Series last night. There's a Bud Light commercial, and they've got Bo Jackson playing Tecmo Bowl as Bo Jackson for just like a brief second. The whole commercial's not revolved around it.
Okay.
The commercial is like Bud Light's doing these cans that are regional. So, like, I would get here in Ohio, I get a Browns can. I should get a Lions can. They're fucking gorgeous. But, like, the Steelers can near Pittsburgh are, like, all black. And the Browns ones are brown and orange and whatnot. Well, so they're showing all these different fan bases. When they show the Raiders, they show Bo Jackson playing Tecmo Bowl. But it's weird. He was talking into a headset like he was playing Tecmo Bowl online against people. So I don't know if he's crazy or maybe they're teasing some amazing, like,
Tecmo Bowl. He has dementia now.
That's sadly a possibility. He did recently come out and say, like, if he could do it all over again, he wouldn't play football and he would just want to play baseball.
Huh. That's awesome.
Bo knows.
Man, you remember that show?
Yep, with Wayne Gretzky and Michael Jordan. And,
yeah. What was that? All-Stars?
All-Stars.
Oh. Dude, that all just came flooding back to me talking about Bo Jackson.
Right? What neat 90s sports. Like, thank God we didn't have the internet, so we didn't see that, like, Michael Jordan was cheating on his wife all the time. Like, we just saw him hit threes and be in a cartoon, so we could imagine them as, like, good people. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Man, I didn't know Michael Jordan was. See? I have the internet and I didn't know that.
I thought he was. And a big gambler. He's definitely a big gambler. Maybe he didn't cheat. Wayne Gretzky had an embarrassing cheat scandal. Like, all the super rich, like, dudes have these horrible, like, wrecks your childhood.
I can afford a divorce. It's fine.
Right? Like, last night I was watching the World Series, like I said, and there was Alex Rodriguez, Pete Rose, and Frank Thomas. And I'm like, Frank Thomas was the only one out of these three. These are three of the greatest hitters of all time. If you had Hank Aaron and Barry Bonds, arguably, those, that's, like, the best of all time. I'd argue maybe a little Miguel Cabrera. But anyways, Frank Thomas was the only one not involved in a major scandal with Major League Baseball. It just kind of tarnishes it, you know?
Yeah.
Well. But yeah, really cool commercial. Bo Jackson playing himself in Tecmo Bowl and talking shit was awesome. So I was listening to the podcast Don't Copy That Floppy, and they were talking about a remake of The Legend of Zelda Link's Awakening for the 3DS. Someone remade it in the Ocarina of Time engine. So it's 3D Ocarina of Time, but the world is Link's Awakening.
That's awesome.
And the way the trailer and these guys were commenting on it, that it's being released as a patch. So it's going to be harder for Nintendo to go after.
Oh.
Because it's not actually the service of a ROM or anything like that.
Okay.
It's not an executable. Like, I don't know. It's, but Lex and Dan on the podcast were really funny. They're like, why would you put out a trailer? Why don't you wait till it's done and then just put it out there before Nintendo can, like, shut it down?
Like, they probably already have a crack team of lawyers. Their patch team.
I think all they need is Google Alerts. Like, every message board. Unless it's
yeah,
like,
that's a good point, yeah.
But I thought that was pretty interesting. And then also, these guys talked about hearing a source that confirmed that the Unreal Engine 4 and speculated Unity would be running on the new Nintendo Switch.
Hmm.
Which is interesting. Maybe they'll get some good indie support or maybe some good AAA support or third party.
Third party?
Maybe. Zarek says that he thinks the Nintendo has already said they can and will shut down modded games if they want to.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. I don't know. Once the patch is out, like, it'll be out.
Nintendo probably just has an internet switch. Right?
Well,
like, one way or another, they're going to get that taken down. If they have to take the entire internet down,
they are quite good at that. So, yeah, that's, but anyways, the Nintendo Switch came out, and did you watch the trailer?
Mm-hmm.
What was your reaction?
I went, well, that's about what I expected.
That's what I thought. And
yeah.
I'm not going to lie. It was a little bit of what I hoped for as well. It It looked neat. I'm going to be really hard-pressed to not get one. If they've got a good software lineup, it'll be
that's
tough.
That's what's for... Yeah.
It'll be...
Because I was watching, I was like, that's cool. Ooh, Mario! Oh, well, that's cool. That's cool. Zelda, okay. Controls.
I do. I like how... Some of the gimmicks they showed aren't good long-term solutions, but they're good enough for some odd circumstances. For example, four dudes that just happen to be around each other with little tiny mini controllers playing Mario Kart or basketball or whatnot. If you went to like a bachelor party even that was like a camp out or any sort of a camp out or... I don't know, somewhere where you're going to be isolated with a couple of kids. It seemed like a neat novel idea, I guess. Not necessarily a system seller. But I'm not going to lie, man. I got excited about it when I saw the trailer.
I don't know. Maybe if I see something else on it, I'll be like, hey, that's pretty cool. Because I think I had a pretty similar experience with the Wii U. I was kind of like, meh, but then I saw some games on, and I was like, okay, yeah, sweet. I want one of those. I'm excited about that.
And, it, you know, there was, it looked like a big focus on controller gaming, which is a refreshing thing for Nintendo, so.
Yeah. That's a good point, yeah.
You know?
Not dumb gamepad gaming or motion control garbage.
If...
also, my new punk band, Motion Control Garbage.
That's a great one. yeah, you know, just... If it has good software and the controller's good, I'm gonna enjoy the system and I'll get it. It's a pretty simplistic, simpleton kind of view, but some people are kind of wringing their hands over certain things. Is it too small? Is it too big? Is it not powerful enough? Some people are mad that the dock isn't going to enhance power, so you kind of get what you get. But some people are speculating if it's like a laptop and it's in charge mode.
Yeah,
it'll overclock or boost clock or whatever. I don't know. If the shit's fun and the battery life is decent, I'll be getting one.
If the games are there, then so am I.
Yeah, really. Right.
I just want some awesome games to play.
There were a lot, and I felt like this when I saw the video, but a lot of people commented on the trailer that it was a lot of young adults that were shown, not kids and family stuff.
That's another good point, yeah.
And, it made me think of a quote that I think I saw in a Angry Video Game Nerd review. Some kid wrote to Nintendo Power, you know how they would answer fan mail in the back of the Nintendo Powers?
Mm-hmm.
And said, why wouldn't you just always market to teenagers? Because teenagers are, quote-unquote, what's cool, and younger kids always want to be older and cooler like the teenagers. So if you just... market to the teenagers, you'll get the younger kids automatically by proxy. I mean, the kid didn't say it like that. It was a kid, but...
Right.
And the Nintendo guy's like, that's a great idea or whatever. But that reminded me of this. Like, if you're younger and you see this, you're not going to be put off, like, necessarily that, oh, it's video games, but old people play that game. I mean, maybe do an extent, but I don't think so. And most of people our age are the ones that buy the most gaming shit.
Yeah. What is it? 18 to 20? No.
18 to 35 is the quote unquote holy grail.
Okay.
18 to 35 year old males and marketing in the 2000s were the demographic that spent the most of their disposable income on like anything, whether that's alcohol or, mostly like booze and video games is pretty much what it comes down to. Clothes, cars, stuff like that.
That'll be our, if we ever rebrand from Classically, booze and video games.
Booze and video games, yeah. Like, we'll get sued by SNES Drunk on YouTube. Be like, what are you, parody channel? What the hell, guys? I don't know, but all in all, I just wanted to say I thought Nintendo Switch looked neat. I'm excited. If the games are fun, I'm going to get one.
Yep. And I say, if the games are there, I'll be there. But what I really should say is if the games are there, Solly will be there. Because he's the one that's going to be in here playing the thing.
God, he will be at that age. Man, if that's a good console, he'll be hooked for life.
Mm-hmm.
And man, it would be fun if just Nintendo got back to just great controller games.
Yeah. Just that would be so good.
Bust out some great games. Make another downloadable Tetris. Like, I know EA has the license, but have them just make a good ass like co-op Tetris game.
Mm-hmm. What if Nintendo was just like, hey guys, check this out. Metroid, Mario, Zelda.
Zelda, and then we promise more is on the way. Yeah, we promise more is on the way.
Yeah.
That'd be enough to go, oh. All right, and it'd be cheaper than the PS VR thing I just bought. So I'll be able to talk myself into it, no problem.
Because mm-hmm. if the Nintendo Switch isn't as powerful as whatever's out when it comes out, I don't give a damn.
Me either.
As long as the games are good.
If the games play fine and they're good, I don't give a shit.
Yeah, I saw both Zelda and Mario in that commercial looked awesome. So
absolutely,
I don't give a damn if it's not HDR, 4K, whatever the hell.
No, and that's why we saw like the old games. Same thing. Yeah. Like, yeah, and if they can, there's a good chance that a lot of good software will be there if they can run those engines.
Mm-hmm.
Even if it's like a scaled back version of the port, like who cares? If it runs fine, I'm with you, man. So, yeah, that's it for news. Dustin, you've got a, can we call this a turkey for road rash?
Yeah. Yeah, Solly was actually really into road rash.
Well, naturally.
Right. I was, because he wanted to play Sonic Generations. And I had, almost said Rifleman. Oh, I was selling a magazine. Never mind. I had to pull out Road Rash to put it in. And when I pulled out Road Rash, he was like, what's that? And I was like, Road Rash, it's a racing game. And he was like, well, let's play that. And I was like, well, okay, let's do that. And he played a little himself. He's not super good at racing games yet, like steering.
Mm-hmm.
Like he wants to, I think it's kind of like a sympathetic squeeze kind of thing. He knows to hold down the accelerator. So he also tries to hold down a steering button also.
Okay.
So he's also always like pulling down to one side. He can't hold and tap yet, I guess.
That's a pretty complex thing to try to get out of a 3-year-old.
Yeah, totally. he probably does like super good. And if other kids his age, he'd probably kick their asses in video games.
Yes.
Oh, okay. Except for that one kid that beat Legend of Zelda when he was still in his mother's womb.
You're still a top 5 3-year-old in the nation.
But yeah, we played some of that. He loved like whenever I'd punch somebody or there are in the PS1 version, there are people who like cross the street and you'll like run into them and it'll make your bike jump. You basically just use them as a human ramp.
Yeah.
Like anytime that happened, he would crack up. Like he was laughing more than anything.
That's awesome. Did he laugh when you would do like the punch maneuver? Like, oh, I can make him wreck, or was it too pixely that he didn't maybe realize?
Whenever it connected, I think it was the punch sound effect mostly.
Okay. Cool. Dustin, you're turning into one of those psychotic baseball dads. Zarek in chat's like, Dustin is already comparing his kids' gaming skills to others.
Yeah, he's already on Adderall. I want him, like, sharp when he's playing.
I was watching Always Sunny in Philadelphia, and Frank somehow got a hold of some stuff called Ritterol, Ritalin and Adderall. He's, like, snorting it all episode, and it's, like, messing with him. I love that show. It's so stupid. It's funny, though. So, yeah, man. With Road Rash, that's 3 weeks in a row.
Mm-hmm.
If you are still playing it, I don't know, Demez. I think we're against you, man. Like we're going to vote pro Road Rash here. Sarah, wild card. That's a Always Sunny reference. They're selling gasoline, and Crazy Charlie cuts the brakes of a van and jumps out of the bat. It's goddamn, that show is amazing. it's so funny. Nothing else? Just Road Rash?
Yeah. That's basically all we had time for.
Wait, what's kept you so busy?
Okay, Saturday we went to the pumpkin patch.
Mm-hmm.
And let's see, Friday night we went to see my nephew play for his high school band. So we went to a football game.
Sweet.
Sunday we spent at my brother-in-law's birthday party.
And then and work that's, and family.
Yeah, work.
That's why you get road rash.
Yeah.
Still, showing your kid racing games and having him laugh.
Yeah.
That's a big win. He's going to love Mario Kart and stuff. Oh, he already likes Sonic and All-Stars Racing.
Mm-hmm.
So he'll be... I loved racing games when I was a kid. When you were in arcades, did you gravitate towards those at all?
Certain ones. Like, I loved Rock and Roll Racing.
Okay.
On SNES.
That's the Blizzard game, I think, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
I don't think I've played that. I used to love Cruisin' USA on N64.
Oh, yeah.
And most people hate that game. I thought it was great.
I remember that being, like, kind of a super arcadey, like, just mm-hmm. kind of fun to pick up and play a few, yeah. I don't know, maybe they were comparing it to the arcade cabinet.
It could be. Which, and it's like a clone of Outrun at times. Sega's mm-hmm. game, so. I don't know. I always loved getting in, like, the sit-down, like, enclosed, like, cabinets and whatnot, and you had, like, mm-hmm. gear shifts and stuff. Yeah, good stuff. So, cool. Well, before I get into what I've been playing, Dustin, I got triple deked by the NHL's TV online service, NHL okay. TV. They came out with a like a special reduced rate to subscribe to hockey
mm-hmm.
for a specific team. So you can subscribe to just one team. You don't have to get all of them at a kind okay. of a reduced rate. And they had on their online service a little enter your area code, and it'll help you identify what blackouts would happen for you.
Okay.
And in my area code, it said Columbus Blue Jackets. I'm like, sweet. So I buy the Red Wings package. I got to watch the Red Wings last night. Sorry, this game's blacked out. I'm like, what? Oh, that sucks. I called their customer service, and sure enough, if I had cable, I could get Fox Sports Detroit, which means I'm not eligible to stream the service because I'm technically in the market.
Oh.
I'm like an hour and a half, 2 hours away. And I technically qualify. I'm like, ah. Oh, well. I was excited and disappointed. Major League Baseball is the same exact way. So, oh, well. And that also,
was,
oh, go ahead.
That was almost awesome.
Right. Like, oh.
Like, getting, like, this whole cable, like, stream stuff. Like, the balance is almost there, I feel like.
We're getting even closer. So AT&T, did you see for $80 billion bought Time Warner Media? So like HBO and all that shit?
Mm-hmm.
Well, they also just announced basically DirecTV. You can get a DirecTV, but internet only.
Huh.
And it's like undercutting cable quite a bit. It's a scary proposition, nonetheless. But yeah, they might just turn on the spigot on your data and say, okay, here... It's just going to work like it used to, you bastards.
Maybe, like, once we get there, hopefully we can start doing some modularity like you were talking about. Like, you don't have to have this entire channel with a bunch of stuff you don't want to watch. You just have this team.
Right. And it's not... So it's like $140 for a year to get all of it. And it was mm-hmm. $110 for just one team.
Okay.
I know I'm only going to watch the Red Wings. That's the only team I care about. And if mm-hmm. Let's say they make it to the Stanley Cup or any time during the playoffs, it'll be a national broadcast. I'll just get it over the air. Mm-hmm. So it's just, yeah. You're right. We're like almost there.
I feel like we're heading in a good direction with like entertainment.
We definitely are. I'm just nervous about the monopolies that are formed or oligopolies.
Yeah,
it's just tough because a market like mine, because I live in a small town, will be left behind as far as internet infrastructure. So I'll be stuck at 5 megabit upload speeds and, you know, 50 down until I'm like 40 or whatever. Like when Nashville hits the spigot, you're going to have to do all the streaming.
Yeah.
But then again, depending on your ISP, you've got sensitive data caps. So I don't know.
I don't know. I haven't got any notices about data caps in a while.
That's
I
wonder good. If they
backed off of that.
AT&T's got it. This is funny. I just got a notice that I hit 66% of my data cap.
Mm-hmm.
And the figure they sent me was like 666.0 gigabytes used of your 1 terabyte. And I'm like, wow, you're like giving me the, what do they call it in the Bible? Like the sign of the beast or whatever?
Yeah, like number like of the
my,
beast.
My threatening email is the number of the beast. If I was religious, I'd be like scared. Like my parents would be like, oh my God.
Burn the TV.
Burn it down. So, all right, Dustin, my morals, my scruples, my soapboxing was put to test. Okay. So, you know how I've talked about the game Tricky Towers. I got it from PlayStation Plus on PS4. It's one of my favorite games this year. I love it. Competitive Tetris, fuck yeah. So I bought it on Steam so I could stream it to my bedroom through Steam Link. I'm the only one on Steam that owns this game.
Okay.
That's it. Me. So I can't find an online match. So, but does my lack of ability to find an online match justify me using my Steam return because I can't use the feature of the game that I want to? The game has single player, which works perfectly. The game's local works perfectly. I could play against a friend if I could find someone else on Steam in the world that would play with me. I could make a friend game with them. I just can't play like I can on my PS4. I wanted to return the game, but I felt like it would be an abuse of the system if I would have returned that game.
Reach out to the guys who made it and say something like, give me codes to give my friends. Of course, make this more professional than I'm saying it. Give me codes to give to my friends so I can play online and get your game out there. But like, hey.
But do it in like I see where you're coming from.
Like, I'm doing you a favor.
Right, a little bit. Like, hey, we'll stream it or whatever. Like, tell them some stuff like that. I don't know.
Yeah.
But the thing is, on PS4, the community is vibrant because of the PS1 freebie.
Mm-hmm.
So,
And if you don't hear anything back, just then do the return.
Yeah, but again, that's still, like, that's not in the spirit of
Christmas.
Of Christmas. Mm-hmm. Of, like, it's still, like, the game is not broken. And even though I bought it for the multiplayer or whatever, it's not necessarily the developer's fault.
Okay, that's a good point.
I do think that based on the policy, I absolutely could do it and be conscious free, right? Like, it is within my rules. I've played it for 25 minutes. I've spent a majority of that time waiting in a queue with nobody joining a game, and I select random difficulty and random stage type so that I can open myself to anybody at any time to play, right?
Mm-hmm.
But I don't know. It doesn't feel like that's the thing to do.
Yeah. How much did it cost?
$15.
Okay.
And I definitely have gotten $15 worth out of it, even factoring in some of the other PS Plus like cost. Right, because I don't play a lot of PS Plus games. So you got to think like it's like $5 a game a year that I actually enjoy. Like, yeah. I unlock all the others, but I don't play many of them. I don't know. I felt weird about it. Like, I was going to return it, and I'm like, you know what? I kind of feel like I'm cheating a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
So I got as far as like Googling how to refund it and just decided not to. Plus, those guys can have $15. Like, I love that game so much. If I was out to dinner with them, I would buy them all a round of beers, and that's $15.
Okay.
So I was also kind of like, yeah, if I would spend $120, I'd be like, hey, give me that back. But they're not asking a lot for it, so I felt okay with that. So
we'll call that the round of beers rule.
Hey. Yeah. A round of beers rule.
Rob rule.
A lot of people try to justify like cost per hour and stuff, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, just a round of beers.
That way, except you couldn't do that with like EA.
That's what I'm just gonna say is like, except like EA, like would I pay $3,000 for this game? No. No, I wouldn't. Zerk says, I can't believe that I switched topics of the new Nintendo console so fast. I expected a lot more puns. It's a bait and switch topic. You'll have to enjoy that, Dustin. Yeah, I don't know. We just... all the Switch puns have been made.
Yeah.
And I don't know if it would be a bait and switch. Like, what if all the shit that they showed works?
Yeah.
Also, outside of being conflicted on whether or not to return a game, I bought Thumper on PlayStation VR.
Okay.
It's a very simple game. You sit down and play it. Oh my God. It is unbelievable. Again, I'm not going to recommend everything. Don't go out and buy a PlayStation VR to get this game. But if you already have one, spend the $20 and get it. The sound design is wonderful. It's a rhythm game, kind of like Guitar Hero.
Mm-hmm.
But you're not playing songs you recognize. But they do this really interesting thing where... oh, you mentioned a marching band earlier, right?
Mm-hmm.
The best part of a marching band is the way that the snare drums work. That's the soul of the marching band. And the way they hit like the side of... like the side of the snare and then like different parts of it to get different sounds, right? So like pretend that you had a band and you split the band with like four snare drums on your left and four snare drums on your right. But let's say the ones on your right are way far away and they play a pattern. Mm-hmm. And then the four that are next to you repeat the pattern. So in the game, you can kind of hear a pattern as the obstacles show up in front of you. And then you hit that exact same cadence as it comes to you. So if you just chill out and like listen to what's happening in the environment, you have the same cadence, and it feels so goddamn good when you like nail it. And so far, it's only like hit left at the right time, hit right at the right time, jump at the right time. But I love it. I've been playing a lot of Super Hypercube. Did I talk much about that last week?
I don't think so.
It's wild because, like I mentioned last week, it's like a wall coming at you with a Tetris-shaped hole in the wall, right?
Uh-huh.
But if you stand straight on, you can't see the hole because there's a big giant Tetris block in front of you. So you have to lean around the block to see what's coming at you.
Okay.
And then you stand back behind the block to adjust it as the hole for the hole that's coming at you. So like you're peeking and looking back and peeking around to make sure you have shit lined up right. It's a really neat, simple game. It's high score based and leaderboard based, and I'm nowhere near the leaderboard. But again, that sound design is really neat. It's super fun. But man, Thumper, God, I love that game. They did make they made me. Yeah, the Donkey Kong in chat's awesome. They made me replay the first level after I bought it through the demo disc.
Mm-hmm.
Didn't save my progress, and I didn't mind.
All right.
My problem, though, is I can't play it at night. Like, if it's too late, it's too... like I'm wired when I'm done playing it. Like, the like I said, man, it's so immersive, the sound design. And it's all... it's kind of pixely, garbagey graphics. Like, there's nothing phenomenal to look at. Your little indicator on whether or not you hit the pattern correctly in front of you is like a mix between the Flight of the Navigator ship and a beetle.
Okay.
Just looks weird. It's inconsequential, but feeling the rhythm and then hitting it correctly and getting it more complicated is a really neat sensation. It's a really good game. Again, it's weird. Like, I don't want to recommend anyone go get a PlayStation VR, but I'm loving it. Like, it's a very... I'm sure the novelty will wear off eventually, then maybe soon. But right now, man, I'm still like...
That's awesome.
It's so neat.
I saw it. It was this Facebook thing. I think it was a GIF. It was a video of this guy. He was doing I don't remember what VR thing it's for, but it's I remember Jeff Gerstmann talking about it, how you're rock climbing.
Mm-hmm.
And this guy, he's doing the rock climbing, and he just falls forward and smacks his face on the ground.
I saw that.
It's
too.
So funny.
But I believe it. Like, eventually you trust that you could lean on that rock in front of you.
Yeah.
That's funny. They'll start making, like adult versions of those, like, baby bouncers. Like, for infants, you know what I mean? Where they have a little tray.
Yeah.
When I was, like, 4 or 5 at my babysitter, one of the kids that was in one of those, like, little bouncy stroller seat things... Went over the ledge and went downstairs.
Whoa.
Nothing happened. Just tumbled right. Correctly. It's like, I've never... At that point in my life, I'd never seen someone so scared in my life as that babysitter. Because she was like more of like a daycare. It was a woman out of her house. Mm-hmm. And there was like 5 of us kids. So she was like, you know, making like lunch or whatever. All of a sudden, down the stairs, Sarah went and nothing happened. That's awesome. Why yeah.
Well, she's like, well, okay, let's never tell your parents about that.
No, she's actually wonderful. But she wasn't a shitty babysitter. So yeah. So she talked about the incident. If I remember, she got on the phone. I assume it was to a doctor, but it probably was to the parents now that I think about it.
Man, all right.
She was awesome. Like yeah, she wasn't just doing it for the money. She loved kids. She loved us, which was cool. So, yeah, man. Anything else you want to chat about before we get to fan mail and comments?
I think that's it. Gosh, I think that's it.
Cool. Our good buddy Kevin wrote in. Do you want to... I've been hogging Kevin's emails lately. You want to go ahead and take this one?
Yeah. He says, from up in the land of poutine, hey, guys. How the hell did you not know that the PS3 played PS1 games? That's one of the best parts about the PS3. You can even make it all smooth-like. I purchased about 60 PS1 games, hence why I was pissed off the PS4 can't play those digital games, and I have a hefty physical lineup. Purchased Busta Groove 2, a rare game apparently, for $10. No, not the bubble one. That's called Busta Move. Crash and Burn is my Mario Maker level. It was named after 80s movies, and I forever have a soft spot in my heart for hackers. Even though as a kid, it bothered me that you can see the screen on their face. It's not a projector, guys. plus, Angelina Jolie showed boobs, and I rewound that tape so many times, it got all scrambly, and I'm not joking. I don't believe Mario 3D World is a true Mario game, but it's a fantastic game. I had it for a review. My review was on the Nintendo page and everything, but it wasn't Mario Galaxy 3. Plus, 3D World is such a weird name because the game isn't in 3D like the 3DS was. It should have been called Super Mario 3D Land 2, not 3D World Land.
I agree with that.
It should have been called Super Mario 3D Land 2, not in 3D World Land. Okay.
Now, usually you're the one that catches it, and I'm the one that's not getting the joke right away.
Yeah. Pocket Morty got me hooked, then I got bored of the repetition and refused to play it to pay for it, so I hit a paywall, I think, and never went back. The Simpsons opening with Rick and Morty is fantastic. It's two of my fave shows combined.
That, Dustin, have you seen that Rick and Morty Simpsons opening? It's like a 2 or 3 minute video, and usually Simpsons openings are pretty quick. Mm-hmm. When we're done, try to remind me. I'll shoot you a link. It's, even if you're not a big Rick and Morty fan, you'll appreciate it. It's awesome.
Sweet. I need to watch that. My nephew Yeah, my nephew has Hulu credentials.
The Jewish nephew, he was like, I'm Jewish.
Yeah.
During your Boston Marathon.
Yeah. Yep.
What are you talking about?
Yeah. My Jewish nephew. That's what we need to call him from this point forward. He has Hulu credentials, and Rick and Morty is on Hulu.
Yes, it is.
So I need to watch all of that.
You like smart jokes, and I think you'll enjoy it.
Let's see here. We left off at, I'm surprised you got a PSVR. As you never mentioned it, I want a PSVR, but A, I'm broke, and B, I might kick Hannah in the head while playing Outlast or something. I usually play games with lights off, headphones, and try to immerse myself, but like you said about being so close to the TV, I don't need that. Since you have a Vita...
I must not have made it that clear. Like, it was an impulse buy. It was an expensive one, but it was impulse. Had those bundles been abundant everywhere, if they were like Rack Pan 3 bundles, where you know it's going to clearance soon, I totally could have waited. But it was like, oh, it's hard to find, and it's right there, and I might like it.
And how much is the bundle again?
It was $4.99, and it came with VR Worlds, which is, it sells for $40, totally not worth $40, but MSRP, $40, two Move controllers, which they're selling in a bundle for $100, and the camera, which sells for around $50 or
$60. Okay.
So if you did it all individually, in the regular headsets, $299? No, $399? Yeah, $3.99. So when you factor it all up, it like saves what would that be, like $60 maybe, if I was just to not do the math? Not a lot, but enough.
Yeah.
So okay, sorry, just had to, that was impulse. So I never talked about it. I didn't think I'd ever get one.
Since you have a Vita, you should get the Metal Gear Solid HD collection. It comes with 2 and 3 and the original MSX version of Metal Gear and Metal Gear 2. I believe it's $20 for you Americans, but 400 trillion for us Canadians, because our dollar is loony.
Do you get the joke with his email? With the numbers?
No.
Okay. It took me a second too. So the way he's got this written out is $400, then space, then 20, space 20, space 30, space 20, blah 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 blah, and so on. Canadian money, it's got coins with holes in it. He's making holes of the currency. Like all those loonies would add up to the appropriate price. Well, I thought that was goddamn clever, Kevin. I'm sorry, Dustin's not impressed with it.
Sorry. Anyways, keep up the show work good.
It was intentional.
Keep up the show work good. Creativity is intelligence having fun. Albert Einstein.
Good email, Kevin. Excellent email, but just because the joke stumbled you, I might needle you and make that the episode title. Okay. Forces a bunch of spaces. Good deal. And Kevin, thank you very much for writing in. Always good to hear from you, man. Glad things are also going good. His daughter's got to be like a year and a half old now, which is nuts. Mm-hmm. Which... it's crazy because he stopped the Paranerds before Hannah was born, I think, which means that they've been away for a while. All right. So let's get to Dumez's comments. Our good buddy Dumez, D-U-H-M-E-Z on YouTube, had some comments. He said, oh, my God, Scott, you hate women. I thought you were a cool, nice guy, relating to my disdain for the Ghostbusters new movie after seeing it. He says, as far as the Warcraft movie, I loved it too, just for the spectacle of it all. I have no idea if Warcraft experts liked it or not, but I did. Gul'dan was the man. Yeah, maybe Warcraft fans hate it, kind of like I loved Watchmen, but the comic fans, a lot of them didn't like it at all.
Yeah.
I'm excited to know any better, so I thought it was great. He said, make sure you watch the Fargo movie. Yes, absolutely. If you have not, it's good too. Yeah, it's awesome. If you've not seen Fargo, it is great. It's a pain in the ass to stream, though. Like, I feel like I looked for it not long ago, and it was either like a $6 rental or like a $10 Blu-ray. So you're almost pushed to spend more money to get a better quote-unquote value.
Mm-hmm.
Stinks. I wish it was just on Netflix. It's from like 92. Like, just let us watch that. He says the DMCA or DMC Act was invented by the Department of Redundancy Department, which is a definite reference to like the British Office, or there's a joke from a British show that talked about redundancy like that, I think. He said, Samsung is wrong for filing that DMCA, and fucking YouTube needs to stand up for them in the channel's defense if they choose to fight it. They are 100% wrong and would totally win in court really easily. Then they could go countersue for damages for abusing the copyright on a clear comedic or parody in a fair use situation. We talked about that. There was no copyright violation, and they used copyright law to censor a joke. Like, on so many levels, I am against that.
Yeah.
Right? So, then Dumbass also says, I am partially immune to the Mandela effect. In other words, I very rarely have false memories. But how do you know? He says, it has been kind of a torture for me remembering everything so clearly and accurately, because growing up, I would argue with friends about shit they would be so wrong so much of the time. He says, I also knew it was always stain in this case, in part because as a child, I remember thinking, hey, stain is close to Stein. Stein would be a much smarter name for them because it's more common. So I noticed it right away, and I never forgot. I don't know, like, deep down, I feel like I remember saying stain, never thinking the noticeable difference, like visually. I feel like I would say Berenstain. Cedar Point, the roller coaster, well, capital of the world, but the roller coaster park near us, they had a Berenstain Bears, cave thing, which was really, really neat. But, like, I never, like, Steen, like, I remember Wolfenstein, right? I don't remember Wolfenstein. But wouldn't Wolfenstein be more correct, maybe? I forget how
probably,
that works.
Probably, yeah.
But I remember Stain, never Steen. Berenstain, I could hear, maybe, I guess. So, Zerik says he's not immune. This is just his dimension. This is just his correct dimension. Which, did you watch that Angry Video Game Nerd video yet? Berenstain Bears?
Yeah, that was like a return to form for him. That was excellent.
Wasn't it fantastic? Yeah. Zerik's right. He's just, Dumez is like the begin. Like, he's the original. Like, he's in his original dimension. Zerik has no memories of those stupid bears at all. Yeah. They were a big deal in Ohio. I remember that. Dumez also says, when you play PS1 on the PS3, remember first to go into your settings and create a virtual PS1 memory card. Holy shit, I gotta add, I just learned this a few months ago. I did not know at all that the PS3 plays PS1. Thank you, Dumez. See, Kevin, it's not just me that was dumb. He says, so I recently popped in my real Mega Man X4 disc, and sure enough, it worked. He also says Super Ghouls and Ghost is what it's called on the SNES. Infinite continues as well. That's helpful. He says, but I
there isn't.
Go ahead.
That's not true.
Oh, it's not?
Yeah, it's Finite continues if you you get more by collecting the bags of money.
Oh, so
eventually you'll get a game over if you keep dying.
Gotcha. All right. Hey, there you go, Dumez. He says better graphics, better level design, in his opinion, because it made for more arcade, more console, not arcade feel like Genesis. He says, both still awesome and cannot go wrong with either. Yeah, and remember, we couldn't remember Goblins or Ghosts or whatever the exact title was.
So, I still don't know what it is.
So we know for sure that it's Super Ghouls and Ghosts on the SNES now. However, I'm second guessing what it is on the NES and what it is on Genesis. So
it's Goblin Stain.
Yeah, this is like our dimension. Like we're crisscrossing streams here. That's why we can't remember it. He also goes on to say that the internet says that the title screen do the Konami code on Life Force. Make sure the logo is not coming into view. Make sure it's static. I'll have to try that. Remember, I couldn't get the Konami code to work on Life Force. And yes, thank you for Googling that for me. That's one of the best websites ever. Let me Google that for you. Have you ever seen that?
I haven't, no.
So if you would ask me a question on a message board, like let's say we're at the Retro League forums, and you're like, what year did the Legend of Zelda come out in America? And instead of answering your question, I would type that question into the initialism for let me Google that for you and put that as a link. And if you click on it, it would just bring up Google and type in their question for them and allow them to hit like, okay.
Oh, all right.
It was like a really trolly, like, hey, lazy ass. It would have been easier for you to go to Google than it is for you to do the forum thing.
Yeah.
Zerik says that Goblin Stain and Ghost sounds like another possible episode title. We shall see. Zerik's also surprised that two people did not know that the PS3 was backwards compatible like that. He didn't think that was possible. So, hey, Kevin, Zerik's like you, thinks that I'm an idiot for that. He says the dumbass goes on to say, the best part of the Angry Video Game Nerd review of the Berenstain Bears was when the alternate versions of the Angry Video Game Nerd says Billy and Jimmy. Billy's not even a name. I thought that was great, too.
Yeah.
And then dumbass lastly said, did you see that Hearthstone's new thing? You can choose a champion to win the BlizzCon tournament. So this is kind of neat, Destin. You can go pick a BlizzCon contestant for Hearthstone. And if your pick wins, you get a bunch of bonus stuff. Gold, cards, card backs. And it's free to do so.
Cool. Kinda cool.
It's fun if you're a fan. Zerik turned me on to that. And it's kind of neat. I picked a Korean guy named Handsome Guy. Because his name made me laugh the most. So, go Handsome Guy. Wait. right? I really wish that esports guys embraced, like, the old school boxing days. Because, like, oh my God. There was one, like, Sugar Ray Leonard. Like, his name's not Sugar. You know what I mean? Or, like, there was one guy, his name was like Aaron Sixheads Lewis or something. You know, because picture like Matrix style Sixheads, couldn't hit him too quick. Like, I really wish that then I could see like my guy's name was like Ilmook Handsome Guy Kang. Like, I want to see that, not just Handsome Guy. I want first name, nickname, last name.
It's like the boxing version of stripper names.
Yeah. Yes. Man, episode titles coming out of our ears. So, yeah, that's it for Dumbass's comment. Oh, he was also first. Thank you for being first. Zerik says that he picked the first American that he saw. He had no idea who these people were, so I figured I should cheer for my country. I'm a traitor. Yeah, but he's handsome. I'll sell out for a pretty person.
It was the halo effect.
Yeah, probably. You know, none of the Americans, I didn't like their names. I went lady in the office pool that's never watched sports that picks like the tournament based on mascots or school colors. They always do well, so I'm gonna go with my favorite nickname. Actually, though, if there was like a guy like Trump not Donald, but the Hearthstone streamer Trump. Like, if he was in the tournament, I totally would vote for him, and he's an American. I just like that dude.
Word. So,
if Day 9 was in, he'd get smoked, but if Day 9 was in it, I'd pick him. So, yeah. All right, man, let's get to Zarek's comment and call it a show.
All right, he says, you guys and your soldering makes me want to break out my old PS3. It's one of the backwards compatible ones. It got the yellow light bug after a few years. I figure it's a solder problem because the towel and hair dryer trick gets it to work for about 30 minutes.
Oh.
I should have thought about this sooner. How much did the SNES cost you? I think I have like four of them. I could have sent you one. I just didn't think about it.
Oh, no, $30. Totally worth it. Thank you, though. It's pretty awesome. If I fuck up this one, I'll let you know if I step on it or something.
I've still never played Red Dead Redemption. I would like a PC version with upgraded graphics, sort of like they did with Dead Rising 1.
A lot of people do.
That was already looking pretty good.
Yeah, I remember being very impressed by it. But
yeah,
I'm pretty, as you can hear, if you've been listening to our show for a long time, I'm pretty easily impressed. by games and visuals, so.
My opinion of Road Rash is nothing. I don't agree with Domez, but I don't disagree with him either. This is my exposure to Road Rash. My mother was a house sitter for a few years. I was with her, and the owners of the house said I could play their kids' video games while my mother was house sitting. Of course, this kid had like every video game in existence. You would expect as much from a family that can afford house sitters / mates. I was presented with a plethora of games that I had yet to have played. I tried Road Rash for 5 minutes and moved on to greener pastures. I never looked back. It was a good weekend.
Nice.
All right. Yeah, sweet. My idea for the poor unboxing of rare old games was something like this. I would buy reproduction games and act as if they were the real thing. I would come on camera and talk about how they were a pretty penny. I would mention how unboxing videos are the craze right now, so I thought I would unbox something that hasn't been unboxed on YouTube before. I would have a hard time opening the boxes and get a bit frustrated with it. I would mention how no one ever keeps these boxes anyways. They're just crappy cardboard. I would make sure to leave little parts of the boxes in the shots of me showing off the cards. I thought I might even use a part of a box as a coaster for my coffee, which would give me an excuse to rip one up even more. That cup of coffee would have to stay in the shots. I was thinking about even tearing one of the manuals a bit on accident or using the manual as a coaster, but that might be too much. Then cut to me using my arm to slide the torn boxes off the table into the trash can during a cleanup session. Do you think that video would have enraged the internet? Yes.
If executed well, absolutely. If you really pull off the... I'm 30. Trust me, no one kept this shit. And he just threw it away. That would be amazing.
I just had a funny, horrible connection. I wonder if the guys at Console 5 give atomic fireballs to everyone who orders things from them. And if they do, I wonder how a Japanese person would react to that. I would laugh if they were confused about a one-star review from a Japanese buyer.
Do you remember Crybabies? Mm-hmm. Like, they were those like super sour gums, right?
Mm-hmm.
I gave one to my grandma when I was a kid, and watching her face was amazing. It was either that or a warhead. But I feel like I remember like coaching like chew, chew, chew. And it like worked. God damn, those were 90s candy was so weird.
Yeah.
It was awesome. Everlasting gobstoppers the size of baseballs.
It made my mouth water thinking about those sour candies.
Right? Like, not alone.
What were they called? Mega Warheads?
I think that was like an iteration of Warhead.
Yeah. Because they were just this tiny little thing.
Yeah. But those smaller were than like, a mint. Kind of like Jolly Ranchers. So if you were willing to bite through that hard candy, that was also sweet too. Zarek says that he was just into the taste of the candy, but it would be because of the name Atomic. Well, he wasn't into the candy, but it would be,
Atomic. So the Japanese guy would be offended by the Atomic Fireball.
Oh, okay. Now we're 1-1, not getting an obvious joke.
I didn't even think of that until you mentioned it. We're both tired, apparently.
Yeah, it's just one of those weeks. So, sorry, any new listeners. Actually, if they're a new listener, they checked out a long time ago. So thank you for sticking with us, old
listeners. Sorry, Zarek.
Yes. Sorry, Zarek Domez. Kevin, sorry about that. He's got one more thing.
Yeah, lastly, he says, I need to start listening to the outro music more. I listened to this week's. It was indeed amazing. The thumbnail on your website for this week's episode makes me laugh.
I found high-res cover art of the Super Spike V-Ball cover. So
sweet.
Edit it. Looked sharp on the site, says Eric. I appreciate the compliment, man. I put a lot of effort into making that site look good for the four people that visit it regularly. Shout out to whoever in Jackson, Michigan. I fucking love you, whoever you are. Seriously. around times when it's supposed, like the episode's supposed to come out, we'll get like a couple of pings from Jackson, Michigan. I'm like, fuck yeah.
Like, sweet.
That's how I used to get the Retro League. I didn't understand how RSS worked. So I would just once a day go to the site and see if a new podcast is up yet or not.
Oh, sweet. All right.
So there's someone in Jackson doing that for us. So I appreciate it. All right, man. Well, that'll be it for this week. Anything else that you wanted to add? Anything you thought about before we sign off for the week?
Just want to say a big shout out to Superman Erection. Just popped in on the chat.
Hey, Superman Erection. Sorry, we're ending the show, but you can go back and watch the video on demand.
The Man of Steel, right?
Man of Steel. That's a good one, too. So this week, Dustin, it's Halloween, right? This weekend. Mm-hmm. Obviously, mm-hmm. Where I'm from, it's trick-or-treat tomorrow, the 27th. But I'm picking one of my favorite Halloween songs of all time. I found a great chiptune cover of it.
All right.
Cover 2 weeks in a row, right, for outro music? Rockwell. Feel like someone's watching me.
Sweet.
So I will be a great... everybody thinks that's a Michael Jackson song because he sings the hook. But mm-hmm. No, it's just it's a Rockwell song. So, his name has a good story behind it. So, okay, cool. Glad you're not a troll. Sometimes towards the end of our podcast, we do get some trolls, so we just be polite to them. But glad you're real. So, hey, what's up? Please subscribe. We record on Wednesday nights. If you're listening to this and you'd like to participate in chat, twitch.tv/classic_leet will let you into our Twitch chat. Subscribe to our YouTube channel. That's a big deal for us. YouTube.com/classicleet. If you like audio podcasts, you can find them on iTunes, Stitcher, Google Play. Our site, classicleet.com, has our RSS feed. So your podcast catcher should have it. But if not, you can go to our site and grab our feed from there. Make sure to share it or leave any reviews if you can. That'd be great. And, everybody, 8-Bit Universe has a cover of Rockwell, and it's great, so hopefully you will enjoy it. Everybody, we hope that you have a wonderful Halloween in the year 2016, and we'll see you next week for episode 204.
Boosh!